Om asato ma sadgamaya tamaso ma jyotirgamaya mrityurma amritam gamaya Om shanti shanti shanti. Om, lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from darkness unto light. Lead us from death to immortality. Om, peace, peace, peace. Good morning. Today we have a very special guest whom I would like to introduce. We are very lucky to have with us Swami Nikhileswarananda Ji Maharaj, who is at present the head of the Sri Ramakrishna Ashram Rajkot in India. Revered Maharaj joined the Ramakrishna Order at its headquarters in Belur Math in 1976, but he had been very closely associated with the Ramakrishna Order even before that. Just now at tea he was telling us how he stayed in the monastery in Madras under Swami Kailashanji Tapasyanandaji, as he was joking, as a half a monk. Even before becoming a monk he was allowed to stay in the monastery. He was posted to Ranchi, which is now in Jharkhand. In those days it was Bihar, from 1977 to 1986, where he guided the rural and tribal development project. Those who are from India, you've heard the term Krishi Vigyan Kendra. So it's called the Divyayan, which in fact received the award of the best Krishi Vigyan Kendra of the country. Later, for 11 years, he edited the Gujarati monthly Sri Ramakrishna Jyot, published from the Ramakrishna Ashram Rajkot in Gujarat from 1989 to 2000. He was head of the Porbandar Center for 8 years, from 1998 to 2005. You remember there was this terrible earthquake in that area, and Maharaj, he was instrumental in a lot of the rehabilitation activities after the earthquake. He constructed 37 school buildings and 3 colonies for people affected by the earthquake. He started the Vivekananda Institute of Values, Education and Culture. If you see the acronym, it's Vivek, V-I-V-E-C, so very happily named, which was inaugurated by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who was the President of India at that time. He was the head of the Vadodara Center from 2005 to 2017. There is a place where Swami Vivekananda stayed in Vadodara. It is called Dilaram Bungalow. So it was actually Maharaj himself who converted it into a memorial for Swami Vivekananda. And this was developed and handed over to the order by the Chief Minister of Gujarat at that time, Narendra Modi, who is now the Prime Minister of India. This was in April 2005. Maharaj tours extensively. How extensively, you should only look at his itinerary to understand, like a whirlwind, preaching the message of Vedanta. He is a well-known speaker in many big companies in India, in their management institutions. He has visited hundreds of schools and colleges for preaching the character-building message of Swami Vivekananda. He has contributed a large number of articles to on various subjects on Vedanta and related subjects in English, Hindi and Gujarati journals. His books, Happiness and Peace in Everyday Life, Teacher as a Torchbearer of Change, and other titles in English, Hindi and Gujarati are very popular. DVDs and CDs based on his lectures are in great demand in India, and there are many of the lectures are actually available on YouTube. You should Google him on YouTube and then you can catch up with some of his lectures. He has traveled extensively across the world teaching the universal message of Vedanta. Interfaith work is one big facet of his work. In fact, just recently the World Parliament of Religions was held in Toronto, in Canada, in the first week of November. And Maharaj was there. I was privileged to be there. And there are others here also, Dr. Bhadrasha and others, Dr. Bhalotkar and some others who were there during those sessions. So Maharaj was there. Maharaj was in the World Parliament of Religions before that in Salt Lake City, Utah. And Maharaj has also organized a significant pre-parliament event before the Salt Lake City Parliament in its center in Gujarat. So we are really lucky to have Maharaj here. And Maharaj has told me how he loves this center, being the first one started by Swami Vivekananda. He was specially beloved of Swami Tathagatanandaji. Of course, everybody was beloved to Tathagatanandaji. But Tathagatanandaji, during Tathagatanandaji's time, Maharaj has come here, stayed here twice, and come here, I think, 3 or 4 times he has come. So we are most happy and delighted to have revered Maharaj in our midst. This program is being broadcast live over the internet on Facebook. So Maharaj will give a talk now, and the subject is from 9/11 to 9/11. So Maharaj has also a way of coming up with very catchy and very interesting subjects. This is very significant because this is the 125th year of Swami Vivekananda's World Parliament of Religions address in 1893 on 9/11. And this is also the city which was tragically struck on 9/11, 2001. So this is the context of Maharaj's talk. I will not say anything more. Maharaj will speak here. He will answer your questions, and then he will meet you individually also afterwards. Maharaj, please come.
Om Namah Shriyati Rajaya Vivekananda Suraye Satchit Sukha Swarupaya Swamine Tapaharine Jananim Sharadam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagadgurum Pada Padme Tayo Shritva Pranamami Muhurmuh. My very dear Swami Sarva Priyananji is very dear to me, but he is dear to all also, not only here, all over the world, through YouTube. And very significant name, Sarva Priyananda. The name itself means who is priya to Sarva, who is priya to all. That is the meaning of his name. And he has justified his name. He is beloved of all. The name given to him by his guru is very appropriate. And I'm very happy to be here once again in this center, the oldest center. During my first visit in 2010, when I wrote to Swami Tathagatanandaji that I want to stay in your center, then he wrote to me, "You see, this is Baranagar Mutt of America. So even before Belumut was started, Ramakrishna was started, this was started in 1894. The place was different. So he said, "We are also living with the same standard of living. If you are ready," I said, yes, I will sleep under your cot, don't worry. So I had a special relationship with him because I knew him since I was a student and he used to love me like a student. So 2010 was my first visit to America and 2013 second visit. Third visit 2015, I could not stay here, but I came here once with Bhadra Ben Shah. She had arranged all lectures of myself and Arunima Sinha, so we were staying in some place. But we came and took blessings of Tathagatanandaji. I remember him very much today. And I'm very happy to meet all of you, many of you maybe also present during two or three times I have given talks here on this platform. So I'm very happy to meet all of you, those who have met me earlier and also those who are meeting me for the first time. And just now, as Sarva Priyananda told, we were together just a few days back at Toronto. The Parliament of World's Religion was held from 1 to 7 November. And we had a session on Vedanta, happiness, peace, health, justice. And it is Dr. Bhadra Ben Shah who took the initiative of organizing the program. And our moderator was Sarva Priyananda, very tough man. So we had to be very tough. He said that I will have to be tough. So we had to finish everything in time. But wonderfully, it went on very well. The Parliament of Religions, for the first time, as you know, that the Canadian government declared November month because it is a month in which Diwali is coming. So that is why they declared it as Indian Heritage Month. And the Parliament of World Religion, the 7th Parliament of World Religion, celebrated Indian Heritage Month and Diwali inside the premises of that convention center in a big hall. Goddess Lakshmi was there. She was worshipped, and some religious leaders from various organizations of Toronto had come, and I was told to give keynote address on Vivekananda, and Dr. Bhadra Shah was there coordinating the whole thing, and I'm very happy she's here today, and I'm very happy to leak out this news. I do not know whether it should be leaked out or not, but it's a small group. She has now become the chairperson of the Parliament of World Religions. She was only a trustee now. So we are very happy that our representative is there. Vice chair. But chair is also a woman. So next Parliament religion, we are not going to be invited. All women will be going perhaps. Anyway, it's a great pleasure. The Parliament of World Religions, first Parliament of World Religion, from there we have come a long way. And after 1 to 7 November, I was there, and I also went, had some lectures in Vedanta Society there, and from there I went to Houston, 4 lectures there, from there to Boston, lectures in Tufts University and Harvard, from there to Chicago, 2 lectures, from there to St. Louis, 2 lectures, and then I came to New York, and we had a retreat yesterday at Ridgely Manor, and before that, two lectures on 22nd at the Vivekananda Vidyapeet, and today evening I'm going to speak at the Vivekananda Center there at Queens, and then 27th is my last program practically. Of course, there will be some small programs. Of course, they are adding up, they are on pipeline, but 27th is a major program, Christian Hindu Dialogue at Long Island, and 29th I go back to India again. I have to start working. I am thinking, I am so happy here with all of you. So now, the topic is from 9-11 to 9-11. Now, mostly people know 9-11 by 9-11-2001. It was, of course, a very tragic incident, and we pray to God that doesn't happen again. It was very tragic. In fact, I became so much nervous as soon as I heard about that incident. I was trying to frantically contact all our friends in America, what happened to them, and particularly those who are in New York nearby. And Dr. Bhadra Shah stays very near to that place. So I telephoned her, and she says that I was the first person to telephone, because for 2 days all the lines were completely off. But as soon as the lines were restored, and naturally she was very much mentally affected, and it's quite natural. So it takes time for us to come out of this great trauma. Even now, you cannot, when I was talking about this in Harvard, they told Swamiji, please do not mention 9-11. Even now, it brings trauma to some people, those who are affected. So it was such a tragic incident. So we don't want that it should happen. Now what we should do so that it doesn't happen? That is what I'm going to tell. That 9-11 we all know. 9-11-2001. But there are many 9-11s. The first 9-11 I'll talk about is, very briefly, is 9-11 of 1609, when Henry Hudson, first European to set foot on an island which was called Manhattan at the time, which has now become Manhattan. And we are in Manhattan. So this Manhattan was started on 9-11. And we are talking on 9-11 at a place which was started on 9-11. And that was started, Henry Hudson was the first person to come. And then there was another 9-11 in 1906. For the first time, Mahatma Gandhi started his Satyagraha movement, non-cooperation movement, in Johannesburg in South Africa. That was another 9/11. And one 9/11 we talked about, and now I'm going to talk about the real 9/11, and that is which happened on 9/11, 1893. That is the first Parliament of World's Religion held in Chicago, where Swami Vivekananda gave his historic address. And as you know, now we are celebrating the 125th anniversary of Chicago addresses. Can you imagine? We can understand 125th birth anniversary of some great person. We can understand the 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda, which happened 3 years back. We can understand the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, which is going on now. But 125th anniversary of an address that was given 125 years back, what would have been the address? How much effect it would have been? With what far-reaching effect it would have been? Can you imagine? That is the address was given by Swami Vivekananda on 9/11, 1893, and you will be happy to know that the government of Illinois, with a charter, has declared, with a big charter, has declared 9/11 as Swami Vivekananda Day, because he delivered that address in Chicago, which is a part of Illinois. So can you understand that? What is the impact of that? That even now today, it is considered as one of the greatest speeches in the world history. Whenever they roll, what are the greatest speeches? This speech will be there. Just now a latest book has come out in India. What are the greatest speeches of the world? The first speech is by Shri Krishna on Bhagavad Gita. Second speech is by Swami Vivekananda, the World Parliament Religion. So can you imagine? That is the thing. When the centenary of Swami Vivekananda's address was given. And you know, the history of the Parliament of World Religion is like this. The first Parliament of Religion was held in 1893. It took 100 years for us to have second Parliament of World Religion. That was held in Chicago. Basically, it was to celebrate this centenary of Swami Vivekananda's Chicago address. As a part of that, it was considered that we should have a Parliament of Religions. And then they said, why not have the same Parliament of Religion committee maybe revived? And that idea came, but it generated from Vedanta Society of Chicago. And then it took form in such a big way, and so many people have now joined, and now the 7th Parliament of World Religions was held. So gradually it is going forward, and it is having multidimensional approach. Apart from interfaith harmony, many other issues are being discussed there. That's very good. But the impact of this Parliament Religion, on 8th of October 1993, the centenary of Swami Vivekananda's Chicago address was being celebrated in the headquarters of UNESCO at Paris. The then Director General of UNESCO, Dr. Federico Mayer, was asked this question: what is the relevance of celebrating the centenary of an address given 100 years back? Then he said, the speech of Swami Vivekananda delivered in 1893 was very relevant when he told this. Now it has become more relevant in the face of the interfaith harmony still needing lot of improvement. And lot of forces still going against interfaith harmony. It is at this time we need this parliament, this speech of this, the message of Swami Vivekananda more than ever. And so it was celebrated in the UNESCO headquarters in Paris. And then Dr. Federico Mayer said, I was indeed struck by the constitution drawn up by Swami Vivekananda in 1897 while starting Ramakrishna Mission, with the constitutions of UNESCO, which was drafted in 1945. So many years he was ahead of times. Whatever UNESCO is thinking, Swami Vivekananda is thinking it more than 50 years back. Same language, serving people irrespective of caste, creed, color, religion, nationality, serving the underprivileged people, women empowerment and development, harmony of religions, respecting all religions, so much so that Swami Vivekananda made a rule that anybody, not even a monastic member, but even a lay member, wants to become a member of Ramakrishna Mission, he or she has to give a declaration in writing that he or she will respect all religions. In fact, we have in our order monks from various nations, speaking various languages, coming from various faiths, Christian, Buddhist, Islam, Muslim, Sikh, Jain, all types of monks are there who are living together without being converted. And we are celebrating Christmas Eve in a very big way, not only in America or Europe centers, but in many of the centers of India. We celebrate Eid in a very big way in all our centers in Bangladesh, 15 centers. We have also the birthdays of Guru Nanak, of Buddha, of Mahavir, Krishna, Ram, all the major faiths, their birthdays of those prophets are being celebrated in all, most of our centers, not only in India, but all over the world. So that is the interfaith harmony, Swami Vivekananda said. So Dr. Federico Mayer said that the message that Swami Vivekananda gave has become more relevant. And may I add, this is what was in 1993. Today, 2018, it has become more relevant because in between, another 9/11 has come. Why this 9/11 happened? If you go deep into the problem, go to the root of the problem, it is nothing but a perverted form of fundamentalism. This terrorism is nothing but perverted form of fundamentalism. There may be many more issues, many political reasons, political and economic reasons. I don't want to go into all to this, why, what is terrorism and how it is about. But one of the important reasons of terrorism is fundamentalism. The people who are sitting in the plane were praying to God and thinking that by killing these 3,000 people, they will go directly to heaven. This is because of the fundamentalism. And this fundamentalism, if we do not say goodbye, this is what Swami Vivekananda had given warning in his address on 9/11 in 1893. Had we listened to his warning, listened to his advice, this 9/11 would not have happened. Now, even now it is not late, too late, better late than never. Even today, if we do not listen to the message of Swami Vivekananda, we will not be able to avoid future 9/11s. If we want to avoid future 9/11, let us go back to 9/11, 1893, when Swami Vivekananda delivered his historic speech, where, first of all, he thanked all the people in the name of the order of the monks and in the name of the nation, and also told how we do not believe only in toleration, but we accept all religions as equally true. He was the first person to talk about acceptance. All were talking about toleration or not toleration. There were two alternatives. Should we tolerate other religions or should we not tolerate? Some said we should not tolerate other religions. There is only one religion which I am following, so I am boycotting. Some people did not join this with parliament of religions. They said what? To sit at the same platform with others? Others are not religion. So if they accept our religion as the only religion, then we will come to parliament religions. That means the basic purpose is gone. So they did not join. They cut off some of the faiths, not all. Some came. Out of which also some were tolerant, some were non-tolerant. Nobody talked about acceptance. Swami Vivekananda said, we do not believe only in toleration, but we believe in universal acceptance. We accept all religions as equally true. He was the first person bold enough to talk about that. You know, toleration, what is toleration? You know, in India, if you go to India, then only you will be able to understand this. When you go to India in the train, all the people are huddled like animals. So much of rush. But when they are reserved compartment, then you have got a reserved seat. But sometimes you file in the reserved compartment, unreserved people come. And they occupy your seat. And then you say, this is my reserved. Oh, have you purchased this train? No, you can't say anything to them. They are in a big group. So what do? You are alone. This is a big group. You tolerate them. This is called tolerance. This is called tolerance. So I know that my religion is the best. I know that your religion is the inferior most. And one day it is going to be vanished by me. I know it is take some time for me to vanish your religion from this earth. But till that time I tolerate you. That is called tolerance. But Swami Vivekananda can say, no. We accept all religions as equally true. And why could he tell like that? Because he was a follower, he was a disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, whose life itself was the parliament of religions, Swami Vivekananda say. Because he practiced, to him came followers of all religions. Christians came, Muslims came, there were six soldiers where he was residing in Dakshineswar. By the side there was a magazine factory, the six soldiers were there, they used to come. And he used to keep an image of Mahavir and Buddha, which is still there. And if you go to Dakshineswar, Calcutta, they are still there. And he used to talk about them. The followers of all religions came for his thought. And he practiced all religions by turn. First, he practiced various forms of that is given in Hinduism. Then he practiced Islam in 1866. When he was practicing Islam, he would do namaz 5 times a day. He would dress like a Muslim. And he removed all the forms, all the images of gods and goddesses, all the photographs from his room. That he was just an Muslim. And at the end of the spiritual practices under Islam, he found that he came to the same point, the point at which he had come after practicing Vedanta and various forms of Hinduism. Then, 1873, he practiced Christianity. Bible used to be read out to him. Then he went to a nearby garden house, Jadu Malik garden house, and there was a picture of Madonna and Christ. And when he was looking at it, suddenly the picture became alive, and the rays came from the Madonna and Christ, entered into him, and then he fell unconscious. He went to superconscious state. After some time, when he was strolling under a Panchavati tree, suddenly he found a tall man coming from the other side, fairly complexioned. And he was thinking, who is he? Suddenly somebody from within him came. Oh, here is the Jesus Christ who shed his blood for saving humanity, who served humanity in such a great extent. Here is Christ. This is what was told from his subconscious mind. Suddenly Christ came, embraced him, and entered into him and disappeared. And then he fell down into superconscious state. He found at the end of each and every spiritual practice, whatever realization he got was one. That superconscious state, there was no difference. So that is why experimentally he proved that all religions lead to the same goal. The goal is one. The paths may be different. So he gave the mandate. He gave the message. Jyotomot totopot. As many faiths, so many paths. And gave a beautiful example. There is a pond of water. From one side, the Hindu is saying, you going and say, I have brought jal. Another side, Muslim says, no, 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 I have brought pani. Third side, the Christian says, no, 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 I have brought water. Fourth side, somebody says, no, 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 I have brought aqua. Why are you quarreling? It is the same thing. If you ask the scientists, they will say it is H2O. Name may be different. You may give any name. It is one supreme reality. You may call Allah, you may call God, you may call Ram, you may call Krishna. There may be different names. But the reality is one. Paths may be different, but the goal is one. This is what Swami Vivekananda had seen in his in the life of Sri Ramakrishna, whose life itself was a parliament of religion. That is why, and he told also, Swami Turiyananda, when he met him in Gujarat, near Gujarat, he said, you know, whatever is happening there, this parliamentary arrangement, it is being done for this one. Can you imagine? Before the parliament region, he has told this. Everything is being done for here. You know, we don't have any expenditure. It is, everybody is doing expenditure. We have to give the message there only. The whole parliament religion, he said, this is being done for that. And that is the platform. He found the platform to give the message of, and he did not take the message, he did not give take the name of Sri Ramakrishna there. He just gave the message of the Indian culture. The message of Indian culture is Vasudeva Kutumbakam. The whole world is our family. The whole globe is our family. And universal brotherhood. He talked about universal religion. He talked about universal acceptance. Nowhere he gave the name of Sri Ramakrishna. Without giving the name of Sri Ramakrishna, he gave the message of Sri Ramakrishna, which, because he had found that, yes, as many faiths, so many paths. We believe not only in toleration, but we accept all religions as equally true. And then he quoted also from Gita and from the Shiva Mahindra Stotra, that how from thousands of years, millions of people have been chanting about this unity of religions and about the harmony of religions. These are the ideas ingrained in our blood in India. And that is why we accept anybody coming. We build churches, we build mosques without any hesitation. That type of acceptance is there. And then he gave all the examples how the Zoroastrians were given shelter in India, how the Israelites were given shelter in India. In this mall, you just imagine, when he started Sisters and Brothers of America, first of all, he was hesitant whether he should speak or not, because he was not come prepared. First of all, he was not being admitted also. This is also a big history. The history of how he was admitted is also a very big history. Can you imagine? He has come all the way from India with great difficulty. They have given him the ticket. They have collected money enough for the ticket. There is no other money available with him. And that was converted by his disciple, the Maharaja of Khetri, Ajit Singh Ji, into a first-class ticket. That is how he could talk to Jamsetji Tata on the voyage from Chicago, from Japan to Chicago. That's a different thing. But when he came here, said, the time is over. We cannot take any more speakers. And where is the credential for you? Who is sponsoring you? Now, he never imagined. He was a monk, very simple monk. He thought when he will go there, he will be admitted as a speaker. So simple as that. And the youth that Alasinga Perumal and all the Madras, they also said when Swami Vivekananda goes there, they will be admitting him. They did not know the procedure. It is very by chance that because did not have money, so now what to do? The hotels in Chicago were very costly. So he heard Boston is a little cheaper. So he went to Boston, and there he remembered that Miss Katzenborn had given invitation. So he remembered when he was traveling in the train. So he remembered the invitation. She was in Massachusetts. So he gave a big telegram without waiting for the reply. He went and reached there. And Miss Katzenborn was very happy. He would take him round, this Swami Vivekananda, in his horse carriage, all round the small village in Metcalf, and show what a beautiful curio she has brought from India. And all will be seeing this wonderful curio with curious dress. And Swamiji had to undergo all this because he was getting free lodging and boarding. What to do? There was no money in his pocket. And no money to go back also. It is by chance that Miss Katzenborn had to go to Aniscombe village, and there by the side was Professor John Henry Wright, who was professor in Harvard University, Greek department. And when he talked to Swami Vivekananda, he was amazed by his knowledge and wisdom. Swami, you ought to go to the parliament religions. That is the best way you can be introduced to this country, and your knowledge can be introduced to this country. Swami Vivekananda said, well, it is for that only I had come. But they said, there is no credentials for you, so how can you be admitted? Then Professor John Henry Wright said, Swami, to ask credentials from you is like asking the sun as to what right it is to shine on the earth. And then he gave a beautiful introduction. He said, where he wrote to the chairman of Parliament of World Religion, Dr. Henry Barrows, here is a man who is more learned than all our professors put together. And with that introduction, Swamiji came, and he was given the ticket also by Professor Wright. And he was given the address of Parliament Regions by the train who was coming from Boston to Chicago. On the way, the merchant met him. He said, I will show you. You give me the address, I will show you. And after that, once the train reached Chicago, where it disappeared, don't know. And the address is also gone. And now Swamiji doesn't know where to go. And he was asking some people. He didn't know German. That was a German area. They did not know English. So just imagine, 9th of September, Swami Vivekananda, because of that great cold and did not have proper clothes, he spent his night in a box car in Chicago railway station. 9th September. And 10th September, when he was going all the houses, they smashed doors on his face, and then he was exhausted. Ultimately, by near the church, under a tree, he said, "Okay, God, oh Lord, your wish be fulfilled. You want that I should die here because of hunger and cold. Okay, now I am ready here for dying." When he was sitting here there for dying, exhausted, at that time the window opened, Mrs. Hell looked out, came, "Are you a delegate to the Parliament of Religions?" See, it is, I am not telling you a story. It is all that has happened. It is not a film. This is all has happened. And she asked, "Are you a delegate to the Parliament of Religions?" "Yes." "Then, but I have lost the address." "I know the chairman. I will take you. And but first you come to my house, take some food." She took him to the chair, the Parliament of Regents. He was admitted as speaker. And then he was lodged in a merchant, in a aristocrat's house. This is 10th September. 11th September, the Parliament started with a big bang, 10 strokes for 10 major religions. It started in the morning. And the chairman asked only 17 people of 17 different faiths where to give reply to the welcome address on the first day. No other thing, just formality, 17 people, out of which one was Hinduism, Swami Vivekananda was representing Hinduism. So he was told in the morning, but Swami Vivekananda never knew it will be so such a big crowd, 4,000 people sitting in that Columbus Hall in the Art Institute of Chicago. He had never seen such a crowd, he had never talked to, they had never lectured in such a hall, and he had not prepared his speech also. So he became nervous. Then he said, "No, later. In the afternoon session, then the Henry Barrow said, "If you want to talk, talk, others don't talk. This is the last chance." So then he stood up and took the name of Goddess Saraswati and remembered his master Sri Ramakrishna and started his speech, "Sisters and brothers of America." And suddenly something happened with these magical words. All the 4,000 people stood up, clap, 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 clap. And they are not sitting, standing and clapping. Swamiji thought, have I made some mistake or what? First of all, he was afraid. But it was applause not for making him sit down, but it was really an appreciation of the words that he had spoken. Now, can you imagine? So we made an experiment, you know. We in Rajkot, we celebrated 125th anniversary of Swamiji's address of 9/11. And so we had a youth convention, about 800 youths had come. So it was in Vivek Hall at Ramakrishna Ashram, Rajkot. Then I said, "You see, you are not in Rajkot, remember. Imagine, you are in Chicago. This is not Vivek Hall, this is Columbus Hall. And this is not 11 September 2018, this is 11 September 1893. And here is Swami Vivekananda. There is a big poster. This is not a photograph. Swami Vivekananda standing here. And Swami Vivekananda says, "Sisters and brothers of Rajkot." And he says, "Sisters and brothers of America," just as he has told. "And now you all stand up and give ovation for 2 minutes. And they stood up, clapping, 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 clapping. Afterwards, they got exhausted. They could not go up to 2 minutes. I said, "I am telling you, still you are not able to go on clapping for 2 minutes." There, without telling, they stood up. And Professor John Henry Barrows writes, there are two big volumes, Parliament of World's Religion, the proceedings of that, where he says, the applause, after when he addressed Sisters and Brothers of America, the applause lasted for a few minutes. And somewhere it is written, it was more than 2 minutes. Even if you take 2 minutes, just imagine. He was given 5 minutes, 2 minutes gone for Sisters and Brothers. And why it made such an impression? Because he spoke from the heart. Because he had practiced Vedanta. According to Vedanta, each and every human being is a part of the divine. And that is what he told later on in his paper on Hinduism, that Amritasya Putra, Ye are the children of immortal bliss, holy and perfect beings. Ye divinities are sinners, it is a sin to call a man, so it is a standing label on human nature. Come up, O lions, and shake off the delusion that you are sheep, your souls immortal, spirits free, blessed and eternal. Ye are not matter, ye are not bodies. Matter is servant, not he the servant of matter. That is what he told later on. But this is what is in his mind. He is telling, talking, he is looking upon them not as human beings, as manifestation of the divinity. And he is really feeling that kinship. So because the words came from his heart, and because he really felt the unity of existence, and he had practiced that Vedanta, and because he had practiced that Vasudeva Kutumbakam, that the whole world is a family, that is why he felt also, these are all my sisters and brothers of America. Because of that feeling that came from a heart, and these words that touched the hearts of all the Americans, and that is how they stood up and clapped for 2 minutes. That is a magical event, a historic event. You cannot repeat it. I tried to repeat it, I could not do it. You cannot do it. You cannot do it even artificially. Stand up and standing ovation. So 5 minutes gone, out of 5 minutes, 2 minutes gone, only left with 3 minutes. Within 3 minutes, he made a history, created the history. Within 3 minutes, he created the history, and within 3 minutes, he gave the real message that is more relevant today than it was given at that time. It remains as relevant as ever. That is why Irina Bokova, when I invited her, the Director General of UNESCO at that time, in 2013, we had an international youth conference in Baroda. So she could not come, but she sent her message on video. There he also said that Swami Vivekananda's message is more relevant than it was given at that time in Chicago, more relevant today. And when President Obama, when he went for the first time to India, he addressed the joint parliaments of India. And there he said, I am proud to belong to Chicago, where Swami Vivekananda, he could not properly pronounce Swami Vivekananda, where Swami Vivekananda delivered his speech. You understand what is the impact of that speech. And he gave portions of that speech also in his address to the parliamentaries, joint parliaments of India. President Obama says, I am very proud that I belong to Chicago, where Swami Vivekananda delivered his historic speech. And when President Kobe, Prime Minister Kobe from Japan, when he came to India, he also addressed the joint parliaments of India, and he quoted not only from the speech of 9/11, also from the final address of 27 September. He quoted verbatim in this parliament. So just imagine, world thinkers all over the world, they are giving so much of importance. What is there in that 3 minute speech? Because for 2 minutes gone for clapping, now only 3 minutes left. Within 3 minutes, Swamiji created that history. So much so that the next day, all the newspapers full of Swamiji's big photographs and his news items, all in great praise. In the streets of Chicago, there are big posters of Swami Vivekananda. They are hung. How this magical thing happened? And the New York Herald wrote at that time, the greatest figure in the parliament of religions is Swami Vivekananda. You know, so many hundreds of religious leaders had come from so many countries. But this newspaper says, New York Herald, the greatest figure in the parliament of religions is Swami Vivekananda. After listening to him, we feel how foolish on our part to send missionaries to India. Their religion is so great, rather we should invite missionaries from India. Great paradigm shift came in the thinking. And Mary Louise Burke has made research on Swami Vivekananda's visit to America and Europe and brought out 6 volumes where she has given all the facts and figures that after this speech, many, many Christian people became his ardent followers and his friends, but few Orthodox Christians, they became his enemies because the income of the Christian missionaries came down to 1/10. So far they were printing in the books of the children. All these figures are given in the children book. All the photographs were there. there it was given. You know, India is such a uncivilized country, uncultured country. There is no religion there. And the mothers are so cruel. They hang their children into the trees so that the birds can take away, eat away. And they throw their children into the rivers to be eaten away by the crocodiles. And they burn the women. And this is an uncivilized country. Send the Bible there. Send the Bible there. These are the poems that used to be recited by the children there. And suddenly Swami Vivekananda comes, 9/11, says, and he gives a very short speech. The whole thing changes. So much so that when he was in Detroit, is the place where the real war took place. And there, a lady stood up. Swami, you are boasting too much about your Indian culture. Is it not true that in your country, your mothers throw away their children into the river to be eaten away by the crocodiles? Is it not true? Then Swamiji stood up and said, yes, madam, that is very true. You know, I too was thrown like this by my mother. But you know, I was so fat, crocodile could not eat me. So I am here to speak before you. That is how he had to answer this question. One man army, even his own friends, even his own friends of his own nation were against him. They joined hands with the other people. He was all one man army. But he had to undergo that. But still look at this 9/11, how much far-reaching effect it had. And it has today. So the most important part of that Chicago address is this last paragraph where he says, sectarianism, bigotry, and its horrible descendant fanaticism have long possessed this beautiful earth, drenched it often and often with human blood, send whole civilization to despair and send whole nations to destruction. Had it not been for these horrible demons, our human society would have been far advanced than it is now. But their time has come, and I fervently pray that the bell that tolled this morning in the honor of this convention may be the death knell of all sorts of fanaticism, of all sorts of persecution, whether with the sword or whether with the pen, and of all sorts of uncharitable feelings between the persons wending their way to the same goal. See the words, powerful words. Sectarianism, bigotry, and its horrible descendant fanaticism have long possessed this beautiful earth. He told 9/11. Today also it is very true. We have not gone far away from that. Another six parliament religions, seven parliament religions, also we talked about inclusion, love, universal love. All those people had come. They were very positive minded. But there were only 10,000 delegates from 120 countries of 200 faiths. But there are so many people. Now, of course, the number of those narrow-minded people is coming down. But we have to go a long way. Do we want now another 9/11? Can we afford it? Can humanity afford it? Do we like the incidents like 9/11 to happen in the history, in the future history? If not, then what we should do? Now it's a globalization has come. Communication technology has undergone tremendous transformation. It's a global village. But where is the global peace? Global peace cannot come till we have global civilization. And global civilization cannot come until there is interfaith harmony. Samuel P. Huntington has written a book, beautiful book. The name of the book is The Clash of Civilizations and Remaking of a World Order, where he says, whatever world wars are going on, cold wars or real wars, we do not know also about these small wars that are going on. They are not wars between countries. They are clash of civilizations. Basically, they are clashes between two religions. It is a clash of civilizations. It is a clash of religions. It is a clash of faiths. So unless until interfaith harmony comes, we will not be able to have a global civilization. Unless until global civilization comes, we will not have global peace. And incidents like 9/11, God forbid, will not be able to avoid in future if we do not urgently go for the message that Swamiji gave 9/11. If we want to avoid the incidents like 9/11 future, there is urgent need that we give importance to the message or given by Swami Vivekananda on 9/11 in 1893. Where he talks about harmony of religion. He says, we acceptance of all religions. If we do not accept all religions, and if we still continue to harbor that hatred, narrow-mindedness, fanaticism, and Swami Vivekananda had used the word, these demons, horrible demons. I think if he had been today, he would have used the word horrible terrorist. Yes, these demons have become terrorists, and fanaticism has become terrorism. It is a perverted form. So then what do we want now? Do we want world peace? Do we want global peace? Then we must have global civilization. If we want global civilization, we must have interfaith harmony. How interfaith harmony can come? Many methods. Number one method is, I call it blacksmith method. What is a blacksmith, you know? The story is there. There was a blacksmith, and so he had a very wise son. So he told, you see, when the iron is hot, at that time I have to give the hammer. So please see that the fly do not sit on my head. The son said, don't worry, I will not allow any fly to come sit on your head. So, but he saw, that wise son saw, that there was a fly sitting on the head of the person who was at that time doing his blacksmithy work. How dare you sit on the head of my father? He took the big hammer and smashed the fly. Fly gone, father also gone. This is called blacksmith method of removing the fly. This is what is being done. Oh, there is so much of hatred amongst religions. Let us say goodbye to religion. Swami Vivekananda says, if you remove religion from human society, what would be left is a society of brutes only. A forest of brutes, not society. A forest of brutes that will remain if you remove religion and spirituality from the human society. So blacksmith method will not work. Second is Procrustes method. Procrustes was a special Greek god who had that feeling in his, who had conviction in his mind that his bed was the most perfect bed in the world. So anybody who will go there, top of the mountain, Procrustes will make him sleep on his bed. And if the man was shorter than the bed, he will just pull his legs and put it in the form so that it suits the bed. And if the legs were longer, he will cut the legs so that it suits the bed. But he says, my bed is the most perfect bed in the world. If you cannot sit, if you cannot suit that one, I'll cut your legs or I'll pull your legs. This is the second method of harmony of religions. The religion said, yes, we want all of our harmony, but my religion is the best religion. And if you cannot come to my religion, I will cut you to pieces. You must, because we have to have harmony of religions, and that can come only when there is one religion. When there are no religions, then there will be no disharmony. So best is that we have one religion. Which is that religion? My religion. And so remove all the other religions. My bed is the most perfect bed. My religion is the most perfect religion. All other religions will lead you to hell, and because you are getting hell in reaching hell, you are getting late in reaching hell, okay, we'll give just now, send you to hell by cutting you. This is the Procrustes method. Third method is tolerance. Let us tolerate, try to tolerate. But the fourth method is the Vivekananda method, what suggested by Swami Vivekananda, and that is acceptance. Let us accept all religions as equally true. They are right in their own way, but you go in your own way, I go in my own way, we will reach at the same goal. There need not be. A time will come when humanity will have to accept this message of Vedanta, this message of Indian spiritual culture, which was practiced in the laboratory of his life. There's a beautiful book, God of All by Claude Ellen Stark, in which he said, there's a big problem of multiple faiths. This plurality of religions is the biggest problem, where one set of religions trying to exclude all others and other set of religions trying to include all others. Both ways it is plurality of religions. And this cannot be solved if you just give a theorem that all religions are equally true, and that is why we should have harmony. Nobody will listen in the modern age. But if one person, by turn, in his laboratory of life, practices all the religions and then comes to the conclusion that yes, at the end of all religions, there is the goal that is reached is one. The realization that is reached is one. If somebody can do that experiment and then tell the modern man who's a scientific bended mind, with the scientific bent of mind, and then the modern man will listen. And then he says, fortunately, such a man was born 100 years back. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa, who practiced all religions by turn in the laboratory of his life and proved that all religions lead to the same goal. So all religions are true, and there are various different methods of reaching one ultimate reality. Unfortunately, we are unaware about him. So the more we spread the message of Indian culture, of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, the more we preach and we become instruments of preaching the message of Sri Ramakrishna, of Swami Vivekananda, what he told in 9/11, in 1893, if it is more and more broadcasted, then only we can be sure that there will be no future 9/11. Thank you very much. No, I can listen. My ears not that bad.
All right. Please raise your hand and tell us your name and ask the question. And don't be shy.
Yes, please. Yeah, Sarva Priyananda is better fitted for this answer. He is always dealing with Maya. You know, Maya is terrible. And Maya, at its peak, is in USA of all the countries. And in USA also, the country having highest peak of Maya is New York. So, but the thing is, what it was told by Sri Ramakrishna was, to know about Maya is that when we know what are the implications of Maya, we know Maya, we are living in Maya, but at present we are not aware that we have become prey to Maya. The moment we understand, oh, we are being taken for a ride by this Maya, the moment you will understand, the moment Maya will have to go. Because once you recognize, oh my God, I was thinking it's a wonderful thing, but it turned out to be Maya. The Maya will say goodbye to you. This is the thing. But at present we are not aware. We think Maya is very nice, very sweet, very palatable. Till that time, we know that basically it is all bitter, it is all packing is all there. It is an age of packaging, you know, outside packing, beautiful. Under that, in the packing, after 2 months, you will find beautiful packing with the food that was prepared during Thanksgiving week. So once you know that this food was prepared 2 months back, then you will throw away that. But till you do not know, you will be liking that packing. This is the age of packing, packaging. Yes, any other question? Yes, please.
Coordinate this along with the preaching of universal religion.
Yeah, very true. In fact, what Sister Nivedita said, when Swami Vivekananda stood up in the Parliament of Religions, it was about the ideas of India and Hindus. But when he finished, Hinduism was created. When he gave the paper on Hinduism, you read that paper, 19th of September, that was the big paper that he read out. Wonderful whole summary of what is Hinduism has been given. Unless you read it, you will not be able to understand. We are, like parrots, we are telling, oh, Hinduism is a way of life. It is not only a way of life, it is full of the fundamental principles. It is based on a very strong foundation of Vedas. And these Vedas, have been divided into four, and these are the repository of knowledge. It has come from the word Vid. And the end portion of that Veda is called Vedanta. And this end portion, Swami Vivekananda said, is universal in its nature. So a time will come when the humanity will have to accept this Vedanta. And this Vedanta is nothing about dogmas or rituals or worships or temples, churches, mosques, nothing. It is just basic about two principles. Two basic principles come out. If you just churn all the Vedas and all the Vedanta and Upanishads and all that, two basic principles Swami Vivekananda says. One, divinity of the soul, and solidarity of the whole universe. Divinity of the soul, just I mentioned, he told each and every soul is potentially divine. The goal of human life is to manifest this divinity within by controlling nature external and internal. Do this either by work or worship or psychic control or philosophy, by one or more or all of these, and be free. This is the whole of religion. Doctrines, dogmas, rituals, worships, temples, churches, mosques are but secondary details. So this is the primary thing, manifesting the divinity. So that is the first part of it, divinity. By harmony of four yogas, Raja Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, practicing in everyday life, you get happiness and peace in everyday life. Ultimately, reaching the infinite happiness and peace as the climax. That is, by practicing four yogas, you manifest the divinity within and reach eternal happiness, eternal life, eternal bliss, eternal knowledge, infinite knowledge. Now, second part of this Hinduism, of this Vedanta, because Hinduism nothing but based on Vedanta, any branch of Hinduism, whether it is Vaishnavism, whether they are Vaishnavas, whether they are Shaktas, Shaivas, whosoever is, anybody who is professing to be Hindu will have to accept Vedanta. Vedanta philosophy. And the Vedanta philosophy, one was divinity of the soul, second is the solidarity of the whole universe. That it is the one Brahman, the principle, the universal principle, permeating the whole world. Isha Vasam Idam Sarvam Yatkincha Jagatyam Jagat Tena Taktena Bhunjitha Ma Grida Kasya Siddhanam. It is the one universal principle permeating the whole world. Sarvam Khalu Idam Brahma. Swami Vivekananda had a first-hand realization under a banyan tree at Almora while he was traveling in the Himalayas. Sat down under a tree and said, he told his brother disciple after the meditation, here under this tree I had one of the greatest realization of my life. What was that? I understood in meditation, microcosm and macrocosm are built on the same plan. And you will be able to, we'll be very happy to know now the modern science says the same thing, that microcosm and macrocosm are built on the same plan. And it is a holistic universe. Bell's theorem states all the particles of the whole world, whole universe, are interconnected at a deeper level. David Bohm has experimentally verified it. He is a Nobel Prize physicist. That is why another Nobel Prize physicist, Schrodinger, says consciousness is a singular of which the plural is unknown. It is one universal consciousness. So whatever are the philosophy of Vedanta has been verified by the modern quantum mechanics. And that is why now the whole world gradually it starts accepting. If the whole world is one, whom should I hate? Whom should I cut into pieces? By injuring you, I am injuring myself, because we are all one. This message of universal love, universal brotherhood, harmony of religions, acceptance of religions, emanates from this principle of Vedanta, of solidarity of the whole universe. And modern quantum mechanics has proved it. We also have to be in consonance with the modern quantum mechanics, with the modern science. And if we really want It's a globalized economy. It's a global village because of the communication technology. But if we really want global peace, then we will have to have global civilization based on this principle of harmony of religions, of this unity of existence, and harmony of religions is only an outcome of this. It's an outcome of this. Very nice question you had asked. Yes, please. Yeah, this is a very good question. Very good question, and of course, this is a very big problem. So see, politicization of religion is happening in every country, including in India, and that is one of the factors responsible for the disharmony of religions. Somewhere, the disharmony is being created in order to win votes. It happens in any countries. It is happening in America also. It is happening in India also, everywhere. The politicians would like to have votes at the cost of anything. This is the problem. So that is why, this is one of the reasons why, in spite of the fact that Swami Vivekananda delivered that message in 1893, we are not yet able to fulfill that one. It is because one of the important reasons is politicians. So I'm very happy to have answered these questions. I take this opportunity. Huh? Yes, any, yes.
If you can give us 5 minutes more. This is not on the subject, but I know the story of Arunima Sinha. It's a very inspiring thing. If you can share with us, I would like everybody to...
Okay, fine. Yesterday only I was talking to her for a long time, and last time, 2015, when I came with her, Bhadra Ben Shah made it all, arranged so many lectures of Arunima Sinha. And then we came here also, Bhadraben, myself, Arunima Sinha, to Tathagata Nanji. Tathaganji blessed him very profusely. And she was also felicitated in the United Nations Hall by a Korean group, knowing that. So the short story is that when she was 23 years old, she was traveling from Lucknow to Delhi for giving an interview. At midnight, some dacoits came. Robbers came and started robbing everything from the passengers. It was a general compartment. She refused to give her golden chain. She said, it has been given by my mom and I will not give. And these people became furiated because all others had gone, had given, and they were all men. And this is the only woman. But she was at that time already a national volleyball champion and a very bold girl. So she refused to give. Then this, and she refused to fight with these four people. Now the four people, the four robbers, they became very much furiated. They just pushed her out of the running train. And on the other parallel track, another train was going. She collided with that, collided 2-3 times with the two trains, and then fell down, and her left leg below the knee was crushed. Then whole night she was crying, nobody came to help. Next day morning she was taken to a nearby place called Bareilly. And at Bareilly Hospital, Civil Hospital, the doctors were discussing this girl is going to die because already gangrene has started and we don't have anesthesia to have an operation of amputation. Now this girl was not fully unconscious. So she cried out, no, I want to live. If you don't have anesthesia, please carry out operation without anesthesia. And the operation was carried out without anesthesia. She bore that pain for 2.5 hours. The leg was amputated. And then she was shifted to Lucknow for 4 days and then to All India Institute of Medical Sciences in Delhi. Now the real politics started. The Delhi government accused the UP government that there is no order, law and order situation is very bad, that a sports girl, sportswoman like her, national volleyball champion girl, is also not safe in UP. So the UP government replied that law and situation is very good in our state. This girl was trying to commit suicide, and that is why she jumped And that is why her leg was below the this crust. She felt very bad. Then she told, no, it is not the thing. But no media people also did not listen to her. So at the hospital, in the hospital bed, she decided, I have got already lost one leg. I have got artificial leg. Second leg also, there are rods in the right leg. In spite of that, with that, I will conquer Mount Everest, create world record. Then these media people listen to me. And she was never a climber. She was not. She was only volleyball champion. But she said, no, I will go to Mount Everest. Then she underwent mountaineering training for about 2 years. 2011, it was on 11th April 2011. This is what happened. In 2013, 23rd January 2013, she came to Baroda for giving a motivational talk. I was at the time in Baroda. Baroda, there is a house where Swami Vivekananda himself stayed. Just now, as you heard, he stayed as the guest of the then Diwan Manibhai Jashbhai. So on 18th April 2005, Narendra Modi, the then Chief Minister of India, came. The then Chief Minister of Gujarat came, now the Prime Minister of India. He came personally and handed over the bungalow to us for converting to befitting memorial of Swami Vivekananda. So then they had invited me for chairing the session. I said, no, I'm extremely busy, but if she wants, she can come here. Then she came. Then very sincerely she asked that I want special blessing because, you know, with persons with two legs also dying in Mount Everest, and it is such a height, and at the same time it's very dangerous, so I want your special blessing. I was moved by her sincerity. I said, you see, frankly to tell you, I can't give you blessing. I can give you best wishes. If you really want blessing, you go to the room of Swami Vivekananda, where Swami Vivekananda stayed, and you go meditate there, pray there, and if you get blessings from Swami Vivekananda, you can do anything. She had that faith. She did not know much about Sri Ramakrishna. She never heard the name of Sri Ramakrishna Sarada Devi, and she heard about Swami Vivekananda because in her childhood, her father used to read out some books. That's all that she had, very faint thing. And though she was in Lucknow, she never went to our center in Lucknow. She was not connected. But she went to that room. She meditated. And after coming, she said, I have felt very peaceful and I feel energized. So I was happy that the transformation comes so quickly. Then I gave her some books of Swami Vivekananda and I gave her the photograph of Sri Ramakrishna Sarada Devi and Swami Vivekananda. I said, you keep this photograph with you. Anytime you are in danger, just pray to them and don't bring this photo. You keep this photo on the top of Mount Everest. Now that became her passion. I have to keep this, that became her task. I have to keep this photo on the Mount Everest. So when she was only 1,000 feet away, the Sherpa said, you can't go. Oxygen is completely out now. So there you can't survive without oxygen. Come back. She said, no, it is there only. I have to put this photograph there. Okay, I will not be able to come. I will die. But let me finish the work that I have promised to Swamiji that I will put the photograph. She took that risk and went there. Went there, put the Indian flag there at 10:50 a.m. on 21st May 2013. And created the world record of being the first female amputee of the world to climb Mount Everest on 21st May. Then she put the photograph, worshipped the photograph, and kept it there and started coming. She collapsed because no oxygen. It was by chance, and I will say it is grace of Sri Ramakrishna, Sarada Devi and Swami Vivekananda, that her Sherpa saw a Britisher was climbing up. And when he saw that the climate has become so bad, it was already 11. After 11 a.m., it is considered suicidal attempt because the snowfall started and so much a breeze going on, temperatures gone down to minus 40 degrees Celsius and all that. So when he saw that a climate is so bad, he started coming back. So before going back, he put down his oxygen cylinder. Naturally, normally they have to have two oxygen cylinders, one for going, one for coming back. So she had also had two, but in between her leg was coming out and all that. Because of that, both cylinders had gone, oxygen cylinders. So he gave up that and he took the new one. The Sherpa saw it. So that oxygen cylinder must be containing some oxygen, he thought. So immediately brought and put it on the oxygen cylinder near on Arunivasina. That is how she survived at that time. Then she came back, she created the world record, and then I told that if you come back, then we will felicitate you. So 9th of August 2013, we had International Youth Conference, as I told you, for which the message of Director General of UNESCO had come, Irina Bokova. So 9th August, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam had come, the former minister, from former president of India. At that time, he was not president. So he came and he felicitated Arun Vasina, and then the journey started. Then she started giving the motivational talks. Then she got Padma Shri and she got Tenzin Norgay Award. She started going to various of our youth conventions organized by various of our centers of Ramakrishna Mission. Now she has become a big motivational speaker, and so many organizations, so many companies, they invite her for motivational talk all over the world. And on 6th of this month, she received an honorary doctorate from Glasgow University. So now she is Dr. Arunima Sinha. And she was so happy, like a small child. Swamiji, now you call me Dr. Arunima. So she is very simple, like a child. And she has that faith. Last year, she got initiation mantra diksha from Swami Gautamananji also. She has faith in Sri Ramakrishna Dev. But she is very peculiar. All these sports women, are, you know, they are peculiar. Moody when she will do something. So anyway, but whenever she has problems, she will telephone. Yesterday again she telephoned. It's a big talk. Anyway, so the thing is this: Bhagavad Gita says, "Mukam karoti vachalam, pangum langhayate girim, yat krupa tamaham vande paramananda madhavam." This is the glaring example of that. You know, by the God of grace, a lame person can cross the mountain. But by the grace of God, a lame person can go to Mount Everest also. Not only a small mountain. Not only that, she told, because Sri Ramakrishna, Sharada Devi, Swami Vivekananda, they took me to Mount Everest. Now I will take them to other peaks. There are 7 continents and there are 7 peaks. So she has taken upon herself the task. Only one is remaining. Already on 6 peaks, Sri Ramakrishna is already there. Sri Ramakrishna said, this photograph will be worshipped in every house, but he did not say it will be on every continent, but this has also been done by Arunima. 6 continents of, already it is there, Sri Ramakrishna's photo. 6 top continents. Asia, that is Mount Everest, then Kilimanjaro, Africa, Mount Elbrus in Europe, like that, 6 already over, only Antarctica, it is remaining. And she was trying to go last time, but she could not get the sponsorship because it is a very huge amount. Anyway, she will go. But whatever I meant to say is that God's grace can make impossible possible. This is a glaring example. A lame person can cross the ocean, can go to all the 7 continents, top of the world, even in spite of being lame, by the grace of God. Not only that, mukam karoti vachalam. Even a dumb person can start speaking. She was not dumb, but almost like dumb. She never gave motivational talk. And now, for her motivational talks, she is receiving millions of rupees. But of course, everything she is putting in her, she has created Arunima Foundation. She is putting in that foundation and doing, she has started a sports academy for handicapped people and also some service activities. So everything she goes there. She lives in a very small house and a rented house. Now only, I think, recently she has constructed a small house, but otherwise she was living in a rented house. Anyway, the thing is this, that Sri Ramakrishna, Sharada Devi, Swami Vivekananda, how they are working in a subtle way, how many people are getting inspired, how the books of Swami Vivekananda are inspiring and how they can work miracles. This is only one of the few examples. There are many such examples. There is one boy, you must call him, Sharad Sagar. He met me last year on 12th January. He was being felicitated at Surat in India. You know, the Forbes magazine brought out 30 persons, 30 leaders of the world below 30 years. 30 great leaders of the world below 30 years, only one from India, and that is Sharad Sagar. And 100 future leaders of 21st century, Rockefeller Foundation has given the name. One of them is Sharad Sagar. And he is so popular, his graduation speech in Tufts University that he gave millions of likes for that. So he came 12 January last year in Surat, and then he said that I'm very happy that Swamiji is here, because I met him when I was 5 years old and I took autograph from him. And he had come for a youth convention in Chhapra. That was it is in Bihar state. I said, how this can happen? I say, I do not give autograph to small children. And first of all, I take the promise whether he will read the books of Swami Vivekananda or not. Then only I give the autograph. Then he showed me the autograph. And he showed this autograph to all the people. 10,000 people were there in the indoor stadium. Then again, she is in touch. It is he who organized my talks in the Tufts University and Harvard now, Sarat Sagar. But just imagine, a 5 years old child, he said, I listened to that youth convention. He knows, and he says, whatever I told, I have forgotten. I have forgotten what I told. He said, no, I remember that a young person had asked the question, when somebody gets angry, what you should do? And then I said, put chocolate in your mouth. I don't know now. I now know the answer. I had forgotten. I had told. He said, I heard 5 years old child. So just imagine Swami Vivekananda, by reading Swami Vivekananda books, how much he has got advanced. So this holy trio, they are working miracles even today. They are there. Swami Vivekananda said, it may be that I shall find it good to get outside of this body, to cast it off like a disused garment, but I shall not cease to work. I shall inspire men everywhere until the world shall know that is one with God. And I think that power is still working. So thank you very much. I'm very happy to have talked to you. And I take this opportunity of inviting you all to Gujarat. Please come to Gujarat. You know, there are 15 places where Swami Vivekananda stayed have been converted into memorials. There may be many more places, but 15 have been converted into memorials. 3 are in America. Ridgely Manor, where yesterday I conducted the retreat. Beautiful place. You must all go if you are not gone. Very beautiful place. Then Thousand Island Park and South Pasadena in the western coast. Then there are 12 in India. The birthplace of Swami Vivekananda in Calcutta. Then, of course, the Swamiji's room. Then Kanyakumari. Ice House in Chennai, the Belgaum, Khetri, and 3 are in Gujarat. Limdi, Porbandar, and Baroda. The places where they have been there. So you must see the places. You know, the bombs that Swamiji threw in America, in the Parliament of Religions, that 9/11 and later on, all these bombs were prepared in Gujarat. Thought bombs. Thought bombs of non-violence. Thought bombs of harmony of religions, thought bombs of universal brotherhood. These all were prepared in Porbandar. When he went to Porbandar, he used to stay only for 3 days somewhere, but there he stayed for more than 4 months because he fell in with love with the, he had a weakness for books. He fell in love with the library of Shankar Pandit, the administrator of that place. It is a very huge library. So Swamiji stayed on for 4 months. He helped Shankar Pandurang Pandit in translating Atharva Veda. He deepened his knowledge of scriptures and deepened his knowledge of the books and all that. And then Shankar Pandurang Pandit suggested, you ought to go to the West. In India, they will not understand your genius. You ought to do the West. And when you go to the West, you will need to know French. So I will teach you French. And Swamiji learned French there. And you know, first time Swami Vivekananda came to know about Parliament World Religions was in Gujarat. First time when he heard about Parliament Religions, that was in Gujarat. When he was traveling from Junagadh to Porbandar, at night he stayed at the Jaitalsar railway station. The assistant station master of Jaitalsar, Hargovindas Ajramar Pandya. You know, this is my latest research. I have not yet given in the books. So don't leak out. Hargovindas, oh my God, it is gone. Hargovindas Ajramar Pandya. He was the assistant station master of Jaitalsar station, and he was the person who first told about the Parliament of World Religions that is going to be held. And then Shankar Pandurang Pandit told, you must go to the West. And then the Madrasi disciples told, and they also collected money. And then Khetri Maharaja converted this third class ticket into first class ticket of the ship. This is okay. But first he heard about this in Gujarat. So what I mean to say is that There are many pilgrim places in Gujarat, Dwarka, Somnath, you can see modern pilgrim places Baroda, Porbandar and Limdi, where Swami Vivekananda stayed. Of course, Gir Lion is also there. So you are all welcome. And now we have started a new center in Ahmedabad. We are trying to develop it. It has become an affiliated center. But of course, the land, it is running an apartment. But we are trying to purchase the land and construct a suitable infrastructure. Then only it will become independent center. At present, it is a sub-center of Rajkot. So we don't require much money. It is 230 million rupees, not dollars, 230 million rupees, 23 crores. I think by God's grace, we'll get it, and we will soon have Ahmedabad center also. So when you come, you have to keep 1 week minimum. Rajkot, Limdi, Porbandar, Baroda, Ahmedabad, Dwarka, Somnath, Gir Forest, everything. And we will give you a beautiful tour. All arrangements will be done by us. Huh? So we extend a very warm invitation to all of you for visiting Gujarat. Thank you very much. I am thankful to Sarvapriyananda for giving me the opportunity of meeting you all.
Swami, one request. Swami, whenever we are working, actually, we always listen YouTube, Swami's video and everything, right? While we are working, we have our headphones. I don't see much activity about Rajkot Center in Gujarati or in English or any language, right? Hindi, English. So please put some of the talks and everything. So I sometimes listen to Chennai Center, some Swamiji.
We have the many talks. There are many talks. They are in YouTube. You can give the lectures on YouTube. Plus, today I have given a flash drive to Swami Sarvapriyananda, which can be copied, which contains my audio lectures. And video lectures are there in YouTube. No problem. Okay, thank you. Yeah. And I want to give a small, humble gift, happiness and peace in everyday life. Happiness everybody wants, I'll give you. Not the happiness, but the book. Then you have to read it, then you will get happiness.